So, good evening, students. Just confirm all of you quickly. So friends, let's start then today's session. Good evening, all of you friends. Yes, friends, let's start. Well, but bit of drown and throat infection is there, students. So, quite a tough time. So, remedy has been taken, which has been there. Anyway, students, we have to continue with our stuff. PGBP, I suppose, hope that now we have all gone through, you have all gone through it, and you would have revised it. So, that the next topic which I will do now would be your. Yes, capital gains. Again, friends, capital gains is an important topic for your attempt. Capital gains, as we all know, that you will have one question at least, both in practical question as well as in the MCQ. So that would be the coverage so far as the capital gain is concerned. Good evening, students. Good evening to all of you. Fine. So let's begin with this. I suppose that now there are students who are watching these lectures for the first time. I may say that students herein, we have made one particular group which is there, and if possible, you can be a part of in the WhatsApp group, and in that you can ask for your the charts and all which you wanted. I'm just writing again the number herein for the benefit of certain students, because then it should not happen that they are randomly searching. So the PDF file of this particular session, or the link of all the other session, or the playlist, whatever it be, of the earlier 11 class which we have covered so far, was about the basic concept. Second was about the PGBP, the scope of the total income, then the exemption, and thereafter we did the PGBP. So these are the topics that we have covered so far, and you can just WhatsApp at this number so that you would be put across in the group. And thereafter, students, you can be the notes, the charts that we are using it, all these things, or the link of the earlier lecture can be shared with all of you. Let's start then, students. We'll do start with the capital gains. Capital gains. Now, my humble suggestion to all of you would be, students, do take care of yourself first very well, because the things are really very difficult. This I have already given the number, so you can put a WhatsApp here message, and accordingly you will be part of the group. Fine. So here, students, in this context, you all just one humble suggestion, students, before I can proceed, please do take care of your health at this stage. It's very difficult at this time. The cases are rising up. Try to avoid outside exposure as much as possible. Have these warm water and all. See, even we are now on the receiving end in this regard. But you have to keep on speaking, speaking, speaking. We don't know from where the infection would have gone. So the point is this, that you have to also just take care of yourself, because unfortunately the cases have risen up significantly these days. So that is a point which I thought that you please take care of yourself. Have one sanitizer with all of you. Keep washing of your hands. And at this stage, if you protect yourself, you protect all the people who are around you. Let's start, students. Students, in the capital gains, yeah, Krish, in the capital gains, students, section 45(1). First section, here it is the charging section. The charging section. And this charging section, students, is a general charge. I'm going to put it across to you in the chart itself, but quickly, the first section you can also take in your notes also. You can write here the gain arising on, the gain arising on the transfer, on the transfer of what? On the transfer of the capital asset. On the transfer of the capital asset shall be chargeable in the previous year, in which the transfer has taken place. You can always quickly note on this particular part. Has taken place. Gain arising on the transfer of a capital asset shall be chargeable in the previous year. On the transfer of capital asset shall be chargeable in the previous year in which the transfer has taken place. So here, students, there are 4 points which you should just keep in mind. 1 through 3 and 4. There are, in all, 4 points. You will take a keep a note on this one. The 4 points. Hello, Trinath. Gain arising on the transfer of the capital asset shall be chargeable in the previous year in which the transfer has taken place. Have you all completed up till here? Fine, students. Now, please pay attention to this one. If you remember, students, under the head PGBP, we had what I have taught you was we have a base amount, and on that base amount, we have done the specified add and specified less. We had a base amount, and in that base amount, we have done what? The specified add and the specified less. By virtue of that, we have got what? My PGBP. And that base amount is the net profit as per the books for business. That base amount was the net profit as per the book for business. And on that particular net profit, which is as per the books for business, I have done specified add and specified less. So far as the head house property and the head capital gain is concerned, students. So far as the head house property and the head capital gain is concerned, there is no base amount in these two heads, the house property and the head capital gains. In fact, if you can visualize the format of your computation, if you all can visualize the format of your computation, we all know, like, house property GAV less municipal tax paid NAV, thereafter the standard deduction, and then last is the interest paid. Same is also with the case with the capital gains. You have the full value of consideration, expenses on transfer, net sale consideration, cost of acquisition, cost of improvement, and finally the capital gains. The short point which I'm trying to tell you about is this, that in these two heads, students, you have to actually do the computation. You have to actually do the computation in these two heads of income. And that exactly is the game. That the fact that you have to do actual computation under these two heads of income, that is what primarily you will then have to do the calculations. So there is no adjustment, there is computation in these two heads. Okay, CG and house property. So how you go about it over here, students, in this case. So the gain, point number one, if I can just give you a note, gain is the computed gain. Computed gain. Okay, just write like this much is sufficient. And you can just write in the bracket, and not the adjusted gain, and not the adjusted gain. And not the adjusted gain like PGBP. And not the adjusted gain like PGBP. And not the adjusted gain like PGBP. One student. not the adjusted gain like PGP. Point number two. Now students, we come to the definition of capital asset. Now students, so far now in your examination, what are you going to do? There are these exclusions and then there is this thing. See, there are only two things that you have to be very careful about it. You have to focus on the exclusion part. So primarily what you will focus in the capital asset concept? One is the exclusion. The reading that you will do now in your revision, exclusion to the definition of the capital asset, that is one. And second revisionary point would be the type of capital asset, the type of capital asset and the period of holding required, and the period of holding to determine whether long term or short term. These are the two things, students, you have to be very careful about it. The obvious reasons are there. Here you cannot go wrong, and maybe in an MCQ question they may ask you, or definitely they will also try to target your understanding in terms of the how you do it in the examination. So that is the reason why, students, here you have to be a bit careful about this particular aspect. I think you may be aware of this particular thing. Nevertheless, I think more all of you would be aware, more or less would be comfortable as well, but still we will quickly run through a couple of quick points so as to refresh your memory on this part. Students, you can just quickly go through it and refresh your memory on this particular segment. So let's discuss this for now. Students, this, as I told you, the areas of your revision should be very focused. On this part, you should have a very focused revision. So let's come to the capital gains, and like exemptions are very important over here for your examination. You have to be very careful on this part. Now students, this is what I was talking about it. Can you see this exclusion part? This exclusion is what I was talking about it. Now in that context, we all know stock in trade. Now other than securities held by FII, okay, that is fine, but other than that, the stock in trade is excluded, will not be considered as a part of the capital asset. Personal effect. But be careful, students, over here. Can you see this includes? So it implies, what do you mean by include? Means capital asset includes high value personal effect item. Capital asset, definition of capital asset, it will include the high value high value personal effect item. So what are the high value personal effect item? Jewelry is there, archaeological collections, drawing, painting, sculptures and work of art. So these are the high value items which are considered as a part and parcel of your capital asset, jewelry, archaeological collections, drawing, painting, sculpture, work of art. Thereafter, students, agricultural land in India, primarily agricultural land in India. This is an important one. IPCC students, you have to be very careful. For inter-CA and IPCC students, you just be very careful on the agricultural land part. This is very one of the important areas that they can target in the examination. And last but not the least, students, in the bonds, can you see the list of the bonds? In the entire list of the bonds which I've highlighted in bold, only do this. Which bond? The gold monetization scheme, the bond which is in the gold monetization scheme. Only do this part for your examination. The gold monetization scheme, this is what is excluded. Okay, now I'm not giving you all the logics and all, we don't have that much of the luxury for the revision session, but still all the important area, students, primarily you just keep in mind primarily in this regard. Okay, students, thank you, Lalita. Thank you. Thank you. What a vicious. So here in students, note number one now. Now let's look upon quickly to this note number one, which is about the agriculture land. Now, just students, I think you all would be knowing it, but please let's refresh the memory. All of you are aware of it, I do know, but let's just refresh this memory on this agriculture land because it's an important one. Please, you have to by heart this. Can you see the slab and all? You have to by heart these slabs. And please write over here, note number one. ICA will ask you in MCQ. If they are at all, this is going to be targeted. It is going to be targeted in MCQ. So, agricultural land in India is any land not being a land which is an area which is comprised within the jurisdiction of a municipality or a cantonment board having a population of 10,000 or more. So, minimum 10,000 primary. In this case, a municipal limit which is having a minimum population of 10,000 or more, that is excluded. Urban land. Now, urban land means primarily, though we all know they have used the word rural agricultural land. So, what comprises of the rural agricultural land? Now, students, this is in the context of the two things. I think all of you are aware. Be careful, students. Aerially, distance is measured aerially. Aerially means, like, if I have to go, students, from say a particular area in Ooty, I have to go. Okay, so what happens is that I start, they will say 100 kilometers Ooty, but that I have to climb the mountain. As such, it may look 100 kilometers, but primarily, if you take the aerial route mountain to mountain, then hardly it may be a kilometer or 2 kilometers. Just that we have to go to the mountain, zigzag everything, and therefore we reach to that 100 kilometers beyond that. So here, it is not that 100 kilometers on the land, it has to be aerially. Aerially means like through flight, if I have to go, how much would be the distance that I have to cover? So that way, you have to see the threshold. See, lower the range, lower would be the population. If you see over here, in this case, up to 2 kilometers, primarily greater than 10,000 or up to rupees 1 lakh, up to 6 kilometers. So the range will increase primarily in this regard, minimum. So through the municipal limit, if you are taking 6 kilometers, so this much should be the population. And if it is up to 8 kilometers, then the population should be more than 10 lakhs. And if, say for example, my land is falling in the 7th kilometer from the municipal limit, but at the same time, does that population which has been there up till that that 8 kilometer radius, has it crossed the threshold of 10 lakhs? If yes, then that land which is situated, that 7 kilometer which I told you, then that land would only will qualify as a urban land, and accordingly it will be a part of my capital asset. Accordingly, students, it will be part of my capital asset. So this is one thing which should be there in this context. So here, students, in this situation, Sidhu, I have already given the chart page. Contact number earlier itself. For the contact number, you can contact there and they will do the needful. Now, please be careful over here. Type of capital asset. Now, these are the sections which are being there. Type of capital asset and the gains. 242A short term capital asset, 229A long term capital asset. So, these are the type of capital asset. Now, students, the period of holding is also equally important. I told you two things. What are they? Exclusions you have to remember and the period of holding. Because in period of holding, generally, which is the area which will create you a problem? The security part. Students, be careful on the security part. Can you see that? So here it is 36, 12 or 24 months. 36, 12 or 24 months. Now, students, 24 months, there are two things only. For 24 months, there are two things only. And which are those two things? Primarily, the unlisted shares and the immovable property. Students, be careful, they are using the term unlisted shares. Unlisted shares. Okay, now there can be an unlisted securities also. Students, there can be an unlisted security also, but not in the nature of shares. Maybe unlisted bonds. So if it is an unlisted bonds, therefore the question is, what would be the period of holding for an unlisted bonds? Please tell me the answer. What would be the period of holding of an unlisted bonds? Quickly. Period of holding of the unlisted bond, students. Fast. Period of holding for the unlisted bonds. Pramnath, Nishank. Trinad, Yashmini, Lalita, Priya, Prasad. So here in students, you all have answered this particular point. So maybe yes, you can say that way, but students, finally the answer is 36 months. Students, the answer is 36 months. You will say, sir, from where you got 36 months? Some students will say that. So students, if you see these particular part is only this, Pramna, this is for 12 months. This is for 12 months. So instead of 36 months, period of 12 months shall be considered for the following. So from 1 to 5, it would be 12 months. Now, if you talk about the bonds, bonds is not a shares. So if bonds are not a shares, then definitely 24 months is ruled out, because 24 months is applicable only for unlisted shares. Or an immovable property. This 24-month rule is applicable only for unlisted shares on immovable property. So that is the reason why this bond is ruled out. Did you got this one? So that is the first point that you should keep in mind. The next point, students, which is equally very important to be considered over here, is that, see here, other than that, if you see point number one, listed equity or preference shares, listed. Now this, you can write, students, this can be listed. Which listed? Shares. Now this shares can be either equity or it can be preference. So this listed can be either equity or preference shares in a company. So what we can say in this context is, in recognized, please write, in recognized or unrecognized stock exchange, in recognized or unrecognized stock exchange. So students, over here you have to be very careful on the fact that listed equity or preference shares in a company, it can be in both. Either it is a recognized or it can be an unrecognized stock exchange. Doesn't matter. It can be in both. So there is a Delhi stock exchange, there are some Kolkata stock exchange. Now these are not a recognized stock exchange. Bombay stock exchange, primarily, that is recognized. So the point I'm trying to draw upon is that, students, if it is about the shares, they can try to confuse you in the examination and they will say shares, maybe say preference shares, listed in unrecognized stock exchange. You will not get confused. You will say, fair enough, it is a shares, yes. Is it listed? Yes. Two things are important, shares and listed. Why? Even the listed is important because we all know if this would be an unlisted shares, then the unlisted part will go in that 24 months part. So therefore, what is required is listed, and the second one is shares. Shares can be any equity or preference. Then in that case, but not security, I'm talking about it, I'm talking about the shares. So listed and shares, wherever listed, doesn't matter. Whichever shares, equity preference, doesn't matter. The period of holding would be more than 12 months. Only then it will be a long-term capital asset. But the moment you say, no, it is not about the shares, it is about the securities. Like the bond example I gave it to you just now. Like a bond example that I have given to you just now. So if it is about the security, then in that situation, students, unlike shares, for a security, bond example I gave it to you, The period of 12 months, students, the period of 12 months will be considered only if it is listed. Where it is listed? In a recognized stock exchange in India. In a recognized stock exchange in India. So if I have to say that it is listed in an unrecognized stock exchange in India, unrecognized. Where? Unrecognized. Then, students, will it be 12 months? No. Will it be 24 months? Not applicable, because 24 months is applicable only for our shares being unlisted. So where it will go? 36 months. Then it will go to 36 months. Did you all got this one, students? You have to be careful. They will try to unnecessarily will confuse you in this case. So that is all of it. So students, immovable property will consist of both land as well as building. Be careful. Immovable property will consist of both land as well as building. I hope that this point is very clear and you will not make any mistake now in the examination. So this much, students, you should revise it for your the capital asset. What is that you're going to revise? Two things. One is the exclusion part, and second is the type of capital asset. In the type of capital asset, period of holding. Fine, students. Now with this, if you're through with this one, students, we can then proceed further. What was our third point? The third point is the most important one. And the third point happens to be the transfer. Students, point number three is the transfer. Now, transfer definition has been there. We know the normal definition. The special case of transfer, students. I'll just do special cases. Special case of transfer. This is what you should revise. In the day of the examination, if you have to revise, please revise only the special case of transfer. Don't revise the normal case. They have got no relevance. What are the special case? I'll tell you the special case. This is what it is. Conversion of capital asset into stock in trade. Okay, that is one. Second is the compulsory acquisition by law. Compulsory acquisition by law. Third is allowing possession. In respect of an immovable property. In respect of an immovable property. And the last one, students, is extinguishment of rights. Extinguishment of rights. So this is, students, they are all defined. 247. If you want to know the definition number, this is the definition number. 247, students. If you are through with the students, do let me know, and then I will just proceed on this one. Now, students, as far as this point is concerned, extinguishment of right. Extinguishment of right. It implies what? That the right has not now ceased to exist in that asset. Your right has ceased to exist in that asset. Then this is an extinguishment of right. And if for that extinguishment, if you have received any money, please repeat with me, for that right, if you have received any money, which right? The right which has extinguished. For that right, if you have received any money, then that would be chargeable to capital gains. That will be chargeable to capital gains. But I will try to distinguish students in this way. Extinguishment of right versus extinguishment of asset. Students, extinguishment of right versus extinguishment of the asset. You'll say, sir, what is the difference between this? Here and here, can anyone tell me what the difference? One, this is for right and this is for asset. You'll say, we haven't done anything like that. I'll tell you, you will then remember, oh, okay, it was this. That's the other thing that you have not realized when you have done it. Any difference between the two, students? Quickly. If you can let me know in next 30 seconds. Fast. Prasad. Pramatnath. Priya. Fair enough, students. Students, herein. Perfect, Priya. Right, when they talk about extinguishment of right, students, meaning thereby, I'll give you an example. First of all, I'll give you an example so that you can understand. Redemption of a preference shares. Redemption of a preference shares is an extinguishment of a right. The right of the preference shareholder ceased to exist. But is it a transfer under the definition of transfer under 247? Yes. I have told you that these are the special cases of transfer. So a redemption of a preference share will will have the effect of the cessation of the rights. The cessation of the rights of the preference shareholder in the company. The rights of the preference shareholder in the company cease to exist. So therefore, students, in this context, this is one thing which has been there. So please write the example here. Example of this one. You write for one. I'm dictating it. Redemption of a preference shares. Redemption of the preference shares results into the extinguishment of the rights of the preference shareholder. Extinguishment of the right of the preference shareholder. And accordingly, the preference shareholders will be liable for capital gains tax. Preference shareholders will be liable for capital gains tax. The preference shareholders will be liable for capital gains tax. Okay? The preference shareholders will be liable for capital gains tax. Full stop. Please write. Extinguishment of the asset. Extinguishment of the asset. Is results into results into the asset itself being seized to exist. And therefore, it is not considered as a transfer, and therefore it is not considered as a transfer but still it is chargeable under section 45(1)(a). Students, 45(1)(a), how do you write 45(1)(a)? 45(1)(a). This is the 45(1)(a). But still it is chargeable under section 45(1)(a). Now students, this is a very important section for all of you, and preferably you should do a question quickly in the module from 45(1)(a). It's a very simple question. I'm going to give you a crux of the working of the same. So students, what is this 45(1)(a)? You will write below this, the insurance compensation money received, on destruction of the capital asset on account of the natural calamity is specifically charged under the head capital gains. In the previous year. Can anyone tell me which is the previous year in which it will be charged? Fill in the blanks. You have to do the fill in the blanks, students. Whether it is the year in which the capital asset got destroyed or the year in which the insurance compensation money is received. Two options. You have to type only one and two. One is the year of destruction and two is the year when you have received the insurance compensation money. Type either one or two as your answer. Type 1 or 2 as the answer. One or two is what you need to answer. Karthik, Nishank, Pratmat, Neeta, Trinath. Indeed, students, you have to be very careful. See, these are the areas wherein you will make a mistake. Okay, very good. You have said it too. Perfect. I accept that. Now, let me ask you one more question then. If that is the case, let me ask you another twist. And let's see what you give me the answer. Trinath, Yashmini, Priya, Nikhil. Fair enough. If you have answered, stick to your answer now. If that is the case, then say I'm giving you this time scale diagram. I have acquired the asset, acquired asset. Yashmini, acquired asset in year one. Okay, the asset got destroyed. Say this was in year four. Insurance compensation in year five. So year five is where you are going to charge. Charge under section 45(1)A. Fine. Okay. So you do the computation also. How you do the computation? Computation in year five is what you do. The year of chargeability is year five, and this is where you are going to do the computation. Full value of consideration, the amount received, less what? Now, whether it is a long term or short term, whether it is a long term or short term, you will compare 1 to 4, point number 1, or 1 to 5, point number 2. What is your answer? To determine whether it is a long term or short term, whether you will compare 1 to 4, which is point number 1 of your answer, or 1 to 5, which is your point number 2 of your answer. 1 to 4, point number 1, or 1 to 5, point number 2. Which would be considered to decide whether it is a long term or short term? 1 to 4 or 1 to 5? Pratnath, Nishank, Dinesh. Will I see 1 to 4 or will I see 1 to 5 to decide whether it is long term or short term? And indeed, that's so pleasing to know all of you have got it right. Indeed, students. Yes, index cost of acquisition, because it's a long term. And how do I decide it? Year 1 to year 4. Year 1 to year 4, and whatever is the cost of acquisition into CI of year 4 divided by CI of year 1. This is how I'm going to give the indexation. Okay, and that will give me the long-term capital gains in this case, or loss as the case may be. Did you all got this one? Students, you have to be very careful. There may be one question in the module. I'm not dealing with this. I'm going to do some module question, but only for exemptions and slum sale. Two things only I'm going to touch upon from your module. One would be exemption, another would be the slum sale. So these are the two areas of practical part which I'm going to touch upon. Okay, one from exemption and another from slum sale. Not required today, not required tomorrow, but will be required in the day after tomorrow class. So students, if you are through with this, now let me in fact take it further, the discussion. Now students, you may not be aware of this part, but you have to be a bit careful about this part. Allowing possession in respect of, even this is a special case of transfer, students. Allowing possession in respect of an immovable property, students, the moment the seller give the possession of his immovable property, say his house, to the buyer as a part performance of the contract, maybe he may not have received the full consideration. The seller, students, may not have received the full consideration, but the fact that he has already given up the possession of that immovable property in the favor of the buyer, in that is the year, that is the year which is considered as a transfer in respect of the immovable property. The year in which the property got registered, the year in which he will receive the full consideration, all these information, students, all these information are irrelevant part of your question. All these informations are irrelevant part of your question. You should not get bothered with these particular part. Did you got this one? So just keep in mind, they will try to give these irrelevant details that he has not received the consideration, he has not received this and that. Please just ignore. Did you got this one? So students, this is how it has to be considered in this context. I hope that all of you have got hold with this point. So for immovable property, it is the possession which is the king. Remember, we were doing depreciation also. In the time of depreciation, the ownership was one of the condition, and in the ownership, which was one of the condition, we have seen in the ownership, what is that thing that we have seen? We have seen that the possession is the king. If the person is possessing the asset, using it for the purpose of his own business and profession, even though the legal title may not have been conveyed on him, still he is entitled to claim the depreciation. Isn't it? So that is what we have seen in depreciation. This is also will happen in the case of capital gains. But in capital gains, it is not for all the asset. In capital gains, it is not for all the asset, but only for one asset. And what is that one asset? Immovable property. Be careful on that part. That is it. Now, students, this too, I will discuss right now quickly. And again, for this too, quickly, you will have to do this question from your this module. Please ensure to do this thing from a module tonight itself. And what is that about this two part? Students, see, conversion of a capital asset into stock into it is considered as a special case of a transfer. So is the case with the compulsory acquisition by law. These are also considered as a transfer. But be careful, students. Be careful on what? Even though it is a transfer, students, even though it may be considered as a transfer, it is chargeable. It is chargeable only in the previous year in which the transfer has actually taken place. Sorry, even though it is considered as a transfer, these two, even though it is considered as a transfer, it is not chargeable in the previous year in which the transfer has taken place. It is not chargeable in the previous year in which the transfer has taken place. Not chargeable, students, at all in the previous year in which the transfer has taken place. Did you all got this one? So in that context, in that particular context, we have to be a bit careful on this particular part. So how it goes with this? First, I'll take you through to the conversion of a capital asset, conversion of a capital asset into a stock in trade. As I told you, it is considered as a transfer. It is considered as transfer, but it is not still chargeable. But it is not yet chargeable. Let's have a look. So here, students, right, conversion of capital asset into stock in trade. Write the section number 45(2). Section number is 45(2). So what will happen? Say here, year of acquisition is year 1 for rupees 100. Year of acquisition is year 1, rupees 100. The conversion into stock in trade, say it is in year 4. Now please understand, this is a transfer. Be careful, this is a transfer. Okay, but this is not the year of chargeability, but not the year of chargeability. And the fact that the stock in trade is sold, which is year 5. The fact that stock in trade is sold, which is year 5. So in that regard, students, stock in trade is sold, which is in year 5. So if you see very carefully over here in this context, this is where the chargeability under the head capital gains takes place. Chargeability under the head capital gains takes place. Also, students, PGBP will also come into picture. Why? Because stock in trade is sold, and since stock in trade is sold, even PGBP will come into picture. Now, students, we need to get some numbers on this one. And the number is, say, in the year in which the stock in trade is converted, in the year in which the stock in trade is converted, say here, the fair market value was rupees 150. The fair market value was, say, rupees 150. Stock in trade was converted, the FMV is rupees 150. Okay. Now the stock and trade was sold here in this case. The stock and trade was sold here. The selling price is rupees 200. Stock and trade was sold at what price? Rupees 200. Now with this information, students, with this information, let's try to calculate both the CG as well as PGBP, and both will be calculated in year number 5. Both will be calculated in year number 5. Okay, so in this context, students, herein, so full value of consideration which you will have, the full value of consideration, students, which you will have in this case, first of all, the CG part which I'm calculating, as I told you, the calculation I'm doing it is in 45.2. The full value of consideration 150. Fine. Less the index cost of acquisition. Now when you do the index cost of acquisition, here the period of holding that you're going to take into account would be year 1 to year 4. Please ensure that year 1 to year 4 you have to stop. Why? Because that is the year of transfer. Although it is not the year of chargeability. It is a year of transfer, although it is not the year of chargeability. So you will have to stop the indexation up till year number 4. So in this regard, if you see quickly in this context, so 100 into the CI of year number 4 divided by CI of year number 1. Again, I'm repeating this point, students. Although we have to stop the indexation benefit up till the year of transfer, which is year number 4. Please do note that this year of transfer is not the year of chargeability. Do also note that this year of transfer is not the year of chargeability. And that exactly is the point. So students, this is how it will function in this context. This is how it is going to function in this context. Did you all got this one? Now in that regard, this is about the PGBP. The next particular point is about the capital gains. The next particular point is about the capital gains. Now, when you talk about the capital gains, herein, when you talk about the capital gains, sorry, the PGBP, sorry. When you talk about the PGBP, so students, the selling price, 200. And what about the cost? Cost would be the fair market value, which is 150. And therefore, 50 will become your profit and gains chargeable under the head PGBP. Profit and gains chargeable under the head PGBP. This is how, students, you will have to deal with this. Did you all got this one? I think the slide got stuck. Those who have to copy down this one, they can just copy down quickly. Better take a screenshot so that I can just do the next one. All of you through with this? We will take a screenshot because I think there was a slipping that has happened. Okay. And then you can copy down later on. Trinath is asking, what if the fair market value was 80? If Trinath fair market value was 80, then you will book a loss. You will book a loss. So your CG will have a loss figure, because then this will be 80. This will have a loss figure. And whatever was the full value of consideration, primarily, in this context, that only will become the cost over here. Be it 150 or be it 80. Doesn't matter. This is how it would be considered. I hope that all of you have got hold with this point. Fine, Trinath. Let's then proceed further, students. If you're all through with this, let's take the discussion forward. The next thing is about the compulsory acquisition by law. This is also, students, a very important section for your examination. Keep in mind. Now, this is also the same problem occurs here. Same problem. That compulsory acquisition of law, it is considered as a transfer. Compulsory acquisition of law, it is considered as a transfer under section 2 clause 47. In fact, as it is to be considered, it is a special transfer. It is considered as what? As a special transfer. But even after being considered as a transfer or as a special transfer, it is not chargeable. Students, it is not chargeable to capital gains. So that is one of the very unique point that you should always keep in mind. That even though it is considered as a transfer, primarily, it is not chargeable under the in the year of the transfer which has taken place. So here the government has compulsorily acquired my property. So although it's a transfer, but in the year in which the government has compulsorily acquired my property, that will not be the year in which the capital gains will be charged. The capital gains will be charged in the year in which I receive my first installment of the compensation amount. I receive the first installment of my compensation amount, students. So if again we go with the same particular time scale diagram, and say cost of acquisition, year one, rupees 100. Okay. Now, compulsory acquisition by law. Compulsory acquisition by law. So that has happened in year 4. Okay. Amount fixed of compensation. So it is 175. Now, in year 5, first installment of compensation is given. Okay, year 5, first installment of compensation amount is given, and the installment amount is 75. In year 6, balance installment is given, which is rupees 100, which is rupees 100. Then in year 7, students, the balance installment in year 7 or year 9, I will say, year 9, assessee receives enhanced compensation amount. Enhanced compensation amount of rupees 50 plus or rupees 50, you can say that way. So this are the data, students, which is there for the compulsory acquisition of law. So let's look upon to this how we are going to take it forward. So cost of acquisition, year 1, which is equal to rupees 100. Compulsory acquisition by law, year 4, amount fixed of compensation is rupees 175. Year 5 is first installment of compensation is given of rupees 75, year 6, Balance installment is given of rupees 100 and year 9. Students, year 9, associee is receiving enhanced compensation amount. So students, what will happen is this, that you will start doing the calculation. You will start doing the calculation over here itself. First installment, this is the critical year for you. So you will calculate the 45-5 chargeability will happen over here. And when you calculate full value of consideration, please take the entire calculation of 175. You will say, sir, but he has received 75. What I have told you, the year in which you have received your first installment, that will be the year in which you will do your full calculation of the capital gains. The year in which you have received the first installment, that will be the year in which you will calculate the full capital gains. So your full value of consideration, students, is 175. Okay. And then less ICOA. Why I say ICOA? Because then it is year 1 to year number 5. Year 1 to year number 5. And then in year number 1 to year number 5, 100 into CII of year 5 divided by CII of year 1. Okay. And that gives you long-term capital gain or loss. And that gives you long-term capital gain or loss. Are you all through with this? Full calculation, students. You'll do a full calculation. Just keep that in mind. Sorry. I'm just made a mistake over here. You'll not do year 5. You'll do up till year number 4. Please make this correction. These are the silly mistakes that you all do. You'll say, sir, why year 4? Because year 4 is the year of transfer. The year of transfer is the only time when you are going to do your indexation benefit. After year 4, the transfer is... it is chargeable. The chargeability is postponed. But the year of transfer is the year in which the asset is compulsorily acquired, which is year number 4. So therefore, to determine whether the asset is long term or not, you will compute from year 1 to year number 4. You will compute from year number 1 to year number 4 to decide the long term, short term, and also if it is long term, to do the CII, to do the cost inflation index. You will also take the numerator up till year number 4. Did you all got this one, students? So that is how it will be considered in this regard, in this particular regard. Okay, so this is how it has to be considered. Now with that particular point which we have done with this one, next blow would be in year number 9, students. In year number 9 also 45-5 will come into play. You'll say, what about year number 6? Why you will focus now in year number 6? You have already have charged the entire capital gains in year number 5 itself. You have taken all 175 and not only 75. So don't now look upon to the second installment of the original compensation. You will just forget it. Now the second installment of the original compensation that you have already have charged in year number 5 itself, but the additional compensation or the enhanced compensation that you have received, which was not charged earlier, that is what will be our subject matter of our further charge. So it will be year number 9, in which case the full value of consideration, students, would be 50, less here expenses would be, the expenses that you're talking about, it would be the legal fee, students, only the legal fees that would be allowed. And then whatever is the amount less the cost of acquisition, this will be nil. Why it will be nil? Because entire cost of acquisition has already been allowed in year number 5 computation. And whatever is the status over here, the same status will be extended primarily in this regard. If it is long, if the original computation is long term, this will also be a long term. If your original computation is long term, then this also would be a long term. I hope that all of you have got hold with this point. Through with the students. All of you. So students, apart from this 214, 247, 451, 451A, 452, 453, 454, and 455. In respect of these section, if there are any practical problem that exist in your module, go through it immediately. Practical problems of them. This is what we have sought to cover in the today's class. Tomorrow then, what I'm going to touch upon, students, would be I'm going to do with business restructuring, section 47. There are a lot of things in business restructuring 47 which we are going to do it in the tomorrow's class. And then the next lecture after this would be, I'll start with the exemptions as well as Islam sale part. That would be in my next session, and at that time we will do the practical problem together, the third class which I was talking about it, because exemption is what is the key for your examination. But please ensure to go through the same today. Okay. What to be done if the asset is compensated for the asset? It's one and the same thing. If the asset is compensated, then the fair market value of that asset, the fair market value of that asset is what is going to be taken into account. The fair market value of the asset is what is going to be taken into account if the asset has been compensated. Did you got this one, Trinath? Fine, students. So I'll see you then, students, tomorrow for the same time, 9 o'clock at 47 is what we are going to discuss. I suppose law lectures are also started now. Purnavas sir is taking in his channel. That is, students, in Advait channel. I'll give you the link if you want in the WhatsApp group. I will give you the link in that WhatsApp group that you are in for the law lectures which are being conducted. So you can join the channel for the law lecture so that you all can benefit from the law revision lecture which is taking place with Purnavas sir in his particular channel. Okay, I'll give it to you, those things, in the WhatsApp group itself. Fine. I'll see you tomorrow then, students. You just do this much. Quickly go through the practical questions. I think I have already created the base for the today's session. Tomorrow, 47, which is your business restructuring and everything on that. Yeah, law is 6 to 8. Perfect, yes. See you then, students.